Hello and welcome to the Talyllyn Railway. I'm Luke. I'm usually the one behind the camera, so you're probably not used to seeing me, but I'm sure you all know Ian. And we're here today to talk about the Titfield Thunderbolt to mark its 70th anniversary this weekend. The Titfield Thunderbolt is one of the Ealing Comedy films made back in the early 1950s. It was the first one in colour, and the general premise is probably quite similar to what you might know about the Talyllyn. So it's a branch line of British Railways is being threatened with closure, and a band of volunteers get together to try and save it.
And we're here at Bringlass because actually this is the location of one of the incidents that the film is based on. And if you've seen the film, and if you haven't seen the film, do get to see the film, available from all major outlets, as they say. But if you've seen the film, you will know the famous incident where they ran out of water because the water tank has been sabotaged in their case. Well, that's actually based on two incidents that happened on the Talyllyn.
No sabotage though, hopefully.
Not sabotage, not in that case, no, no. First instance was at Dolgoch, when they took Dolgoch itself, the old lady, as she's referred to back then, up there on a test run, and found that the water tank was empty because the pipe connecting it had got blocked, and they'd had to limp all the way back down to Pendra, and they just made it. But the more famous incident, and the incident that's actually recorded in the film, is actually took place here at Bringlass.
Right. That's why you dragged me out here in the middle.
Well,
of
you know, that's it. That's it. And it relates to the fact that one evening they had an evening charter, but the water supply at Pendray had failed, and so they decided that they would try and get up as far as Dolgoch and fill the water loco's tank up there.
This was quite early.
Early 1951, early in the running season, etc. And they got as far as here and realised they weren't going to make it any further. So had a choice. You either sort of, you know, extinguish the fire completely, or you try and find a source of water. Now, fortunately, and you might just hear it babbling away in the background, there is a strong source of water here. There's a stream that runs just under part of the station here. But of course, then the problem comes of what do you fill the loco with? And fortunately, there is Bringlass Farm, which is just up there. And
I'm seeing how all the dots are connecting here.
Yeah, that's it. And so there was, in Tom Volt records it in his book Railway Adventure, he says, you know, there's a sight of the train crew heading up the hill at a very rapid pace to get sort of buckets and anything else that would hold some water to come down and sort of fill the tank up as best they could.
That's exactly what happens in the film.
So as best as it,
all the passengers pile off the train running up to the farm.
How much the passenger? Yeah, yeah.
A bathtub.
That's it. So it is one of the more memorable incidents in the film.
That's directly based on something that happened here.
Yeah, that's it. But it's not the only real connection between the Talyllyn. It's not just that incident. In fact, the story of the Talyllyn's involvement with the film seems to go back into early 1951, when the scriptwriter, T.B. Clarke, seems to have been on holiday in the area, happened upon the railway.
Yeah, as many people seem to have done.
Yeah, that's it. Didn't realise perhaps his history, but was fascinated apparently by a sign that said wanted volunteer plate layers, and sort of inquired about it and discovered the story of the railway. And that obviously served as a bit of a thought in his mind.
Yeah, and obviously at that point, 1951, we were the only preserved railway in the world.
That's right, we were unique at that point. And so it's obviously something formed in his mind that this could be the basis of a film. And obviously pitched it to Ealing Studios, who gave him the go-ahead to sort of prepare a script. And so we have a letter in the archive, in fact, from him to Tom Rolt, the general manager at the time, dated the 18th of September, if I recall correctly, asking whether he could come down the following week for a day or so and have a conversation about the railway, you know, and outline the sort of script outline that he'd obviously pitched to Ealing about closing a branch line and a group of local enthusiasts taking it over. And so he came down, chatted with Walt over the course of a day or so, and got a lot of the background, a lot of information. And so, right, as well as just the sort of specific incidents like we've just talked about, there's actually quite a bit in the film which either consciously or unconsciously echoes the Talyllyn story. I mean, you know, right at the beginning of the film, you have, you know, the meeting between the vicar, the squire, and the town clerk about the, you know, the Titfield railway being closed, and that kind of echoes what happened in Banbury in a radio store owned by Bill Trinder, where Tom Rolt, Bill Trinder, and Jim Russell were meeting and discussing about the railway and the future of the railway and ways in which it could be sort of saved back in sort of 1949-50. If you like, the film then progresses and you see the other instance, you know, they ask the question, well, how are we going to afford to buy it, etc. And it's kind of interesting because Clark wasn't a railway enthusiast.
No.
In fact, none of the main people involved in making the film were railway enthusiasts. It wasn't a sort of railway buff film.
No. And I think there is at least one person, but we can probably come back to that.
Yeah, there is one person. We'll come back to that person in a moment. But he obviously had talked to railway people because, I mean, there's mention in the film of getting a light railway order and things like that. Which...
Gucci's 222 with a double crank driving axle.
I did once mount the North Star. You know, Gucci's 222 with a double crank driving axle.
Yeah. You know, so he'd obviously, you know, got people who knew something about the subject to advise him on it. So that was kind of helpful. But, you know, you then have this scene in the local hostelry where they're trying to get Mr. Valentine, you know, to fund the railway, basically to pay for it, and again that has some echoes of the early days of society where they held a public meeting in Birmingham and they were trying to encourage people, you know, to get involved with
that spread into the press.
Gained
a lot of traction for the TR.
And they had to make clear, a bit like the vicar had to make clear to Mr. Valentine, you know, they weren't going to make any money out of it. but they had to kind of, you know, sell it to people as to how they had it. And then, of course, there is the famous scene in the film between the vicar and Dan. And, you know...
And Dan is a retired railwayman.
That's right, it's the retired railwayman. And I think that has some echoes, if you like, of the potential tension that there was in the early days of society when, if you say, like, I think there was a little bit of an attitude of some of the preservationists that we are now going to come and run your railway properly. As opposed to the folk who had been here and had struggled to keep
it for years.
Yeah, and running it for years
on a shoestring,
holding it together and all the rest of it. And they have this
may have been a little clash.
I think so. And I think so. You have this wonderful scene between the two of them in the film.
Dan, what's your petticoat pipe?
Mr. Reach.
What's the purpose of the firebox throat plate?
When does an engine bark?
What's a stuffing glam?
How long's your J-rod?
How'd your 3 o'clock blower?
How'd you treat a big end brass?
Will you answer my questions, man?
Will you answer mine and take your paws off me?
So you have things like that. So there are these little elements of the Talyllyn story in it, as I said, sort of consciously, subconsciously, that take place. And then we did say we'd talk about someone who...
Yeah, so Dan, the railway man, is played by Hugh Griffith. And he had quite a little bit of a connection with the Talyllyn. I'm right in saying he was a good friend of Tom Rolt, who's one of our founding members.
Yeah.
And coincidentally, around September 1951, when that letter, that remarkably still survives, was sent, Hugh was made a vice president of the Preservation Society, correct?
Yeah, he was one of the first vice presidents. So that could have been in Tom Rolt's mind when Clark came here and had the conversations. Yeah. And it might have been part of the reason for the casting. Yeah, yeah. We don't know.
Perhaps Tom tried to get his mate a bit of work.
yeah, or, you know, knowing that he knew he had the connection with the railway and things like, I don't know, but it was shall we say, it's one of those happy things.
Yeah, it strengthens our connection to the film, quite literally on the screen as well.
Yeah, that's it. And you know, sort of adds that another dimension to the entire thing, connection to the film. And I think, you know, we can look for lots of other things in the film.
Certainly.
You know,
there's probably a lot of relations to other preserved railway stories out there as well.
Yeah, obviously, I think
it comes before the vast majority of other preserved railways, but I'm sure anyone who's been involved with the Heritage Railway can probably relate to that film on some level.
Yeah, and I mean, if you read Tom Rolfe's Railway Adventure, which is the story of the first 2 years, you see how many of the connections, you know, the trains derailing and things like that. That sort of,
well, it wasn't one of the hopes of Tom Rolfe was that the film itself could have been filmed here.
Yeah, I think there was a hope for it to be filmed here, and I think there was some further correspondence between Rolfe and Clark.
I imagine at the time, number three falling between our rails may have interfered with filming schedules, perhaps.
Yeah, yeah. And though we ought to make clear, there was no rivalry with the local bus company or anything like that. No sabotage. Nothing like that.
Not as exciting in its own way.
That is purely, shall we say, comedic invention for the purpose of the film. But interestingly enough, and we say there are possibly these unconscious connections.
Yeah.
June 1952, the railway inspector came to inspect the railway, and Rolfe records in Railway Adventure that they really weren't looking forward to this. They were really nervous about it, and he would have known about this before filming it was taking. Certainly, principal filming was underway on the film. So whether he mentioned it to Clark, whether Clark got wind of this was happening and therefore wrote it into the story.
The big climax, the hinge of the climax is the railway inspectorate making sure they can sensibly run a railway as amateurs, if you would.
Well, that's right, because it was a big thing, and that certainly in the film sort of comes over, and it was sort of a big thing in the press at the time.
I think now we kind of do take it for we do take it for granted that steam railways are run by volunteers for the most part.
Yeah.
Whereas back in the 50s, we were the only one.
Yeah.
For the very early part of the 50s, at the very least, you know, nobody else was doing it. So there was quite a lot of, certainly in the film, there's quite a lot of doubt about that, and I can understand why.
Yeah. I think that's very true, and I think, you know, this was a big thing in the national press at the time. I mean, you know, the BBC would come here and film, you know, two or three events in the opening days of the Talyllyn Run, and the first two or three seasons they were here in national press. It got in the national press and was featured and everything else, because this concept of volunteers taking over this railway
was unheard of.
Yeah, it was brand new. It was brand new thinking. And, you know, in one sense, you know, those early pioneers were remarkable people. And, you know, in a sense that comes over in the film as well, that they took something on. Perhaps they didn't have the full idea of what it was that they were doing, but they did it with the best of intentions.
Certainly.
And they made a difference. And, you know, it's interesting, Tom Rolfe was a fascinating character himself. And I mean, in a sense, had a major influence on the preservation world in two spheres, because
the canals,
because he was also one of the founders of the Inland Waterways Association.
Mm. Well, his love before the TR.
Yeah, that's right. It was before the Talyllyn, and you know, the Inland Waterways Association has transformed Britain's canals. Mm. And in a sense too, Talyllyn Railway, the example of Talyllyn Railway, has been a global phenomenon in a sense, because other
formed the railroad just heritage movement around the world.
Yes.
You know, it might have taken a different form without the Talyllyn, you know, it probably would happen in some way, but the way we have it now is because of what those early volunteers set out to do here on the TR.
Yes,
I think it set that example.
That's it. I think that's very true. I mean, Rolt and Trinder and Russell did have in mind that they kind of wanted to recapture the atmosphere of the railways pre-nationalisation. Rolt wasn't a fan of nationalisation, quite clearly, and so they wanted to recapture the atmosphere of pre-preservation. So it's kind of interesting, again, another Titfield connection, that Titfield is supposedly an ex-GWR branch line.
Yes.
And it's quite clear that Rolt, Trinder and Russell had in mind a sort of
Great
Westernist thing in the choice of livery.
Certainly in the 60s, you start seeing white buffers and head codes appearing on our engines.
Yeah, and I think they had that sort of, recapture that atmosphere.
And green.
that was there. But, that was their motivation. But, achieved.
Yeah, and that very much does play into the essence of the Titfield Thunderbolt as a film. It keeps that kind of at its core.
Yeah.
And it's a pleasure to be affiliated with it and to say, look, this film was inspired by us. And that it's also just a very good film.
It is a good film. It wasn't quite as appreciated at the time as some of the other Ealing comedies. But I think, Passport to Pimlico, Lavender Hill Mob, etc., which were other films that Clark had the script written for. He was the script writer for both of those. They capture a moment, they capture a period in time and a piece of social history, and they capture that in a story, yes, but there is so much of the story that is influenced by what was taking place in the real world at the time. And I think in that sense, Titfield fits very much into that. It is a little time capsule, if you like, of that period in the early 1950s and what happened here on the Talyllyn, and the rest, as they say, is history.
Yeah. So, as I said, this has been kind of celebrating 70 years of the Titfield Thunderbolt. And while we're not exactly doing it, we have been helping them. Rapido Trains UK, a model manufacturer, are doing some gorgeous models of the train and the bus from the Titfield Thunderbolt. So if I pass you over to my friend at Rapido, he'll tell you a little bit about what they've been up to.
Hello, it's Corwin from Rapido Trains UK here. Just want to say that we're thrilled to be celebrating the anniversary of the Titfield Thunderbolt, a film that has meant so much to us over the years. As you may know, we're bringing out a range of models for this, including the Titfield train pack with sounds from the film, the buffet car with bar inside it, and of course the Bedford OB bus owned by Pierce and Crump. Inside the train packs is an exclusive booklet, and we are so, so grateful to the Talyllyn Railway for the help that they've given us in providing some of the information and the images for this book. We hope that you enjoy the models and that they provide inspiration to you, just as Titfield and the Talyllyn have provided for us. Thanks very much.
Thanks for that, Corwin. So those models, I think, are going to be absolutely gorgeous. Yep. I've got far too much money invested in pre-orders at the moment. Yes. So is there anything else going on, Titfield-wise?
Yeah, I mean, it's mentioned there's a special exhibition in the Narrowgauge Railway Museum looking back 70 years, because there's a number of events back 70 years ago, a little thing called Coronation and things like that happened, and things like that. So there's a little bit of retrospective on that, and that also has a bit about Titfield in it as well.
Lovely.
And I think there might just be one or two other things happening sort of Titfield-related across the year.
Excellent. So. Well, we'll look forward to those. Thanks so much for watching.
Thank you.
Bye.